Hello everyone, this is Sukruti Joshi from LG Institute of Engineering and Technology. I am going to take the video lecture series on chemistry. The subject code for chemistry is 311-0001. Till now, in this video lecture series, we have started our chapter number 8, which is analytical techniques. Okay, now in that we have started conductometric titration. Conductometric titration is basically the titration in which we will actually identify the conductance which is passed through the solution, and through that solution we get to know about the identification of that particular compound or the end point or neutralization point which is present or which is done during that particular reaction. We can actually get to know about any step of that particular reaction. Okay, in that we have studied about the conductance. So conductance is basically the ability of an ion to pass the electricity through it. This is a simple definition. Simple, so you can get another one also, right? But it is generally a flow of current which is passed through that ion solution that plays an important role, okay, and through which we will actually obtain the results, right? Now here we have seen the application of conductometric titration in strong acid versus strong base titration, where we can get the neutralization point which is the lowest conductance value, can be perfectly analyzed at that particular time. Now let's move ahead to the next application, which involves strong acid versus weak base. Okay, there's a titration which is done with strong acid versus weak base. So the titration of a strong acid with moderately weak base may be illustrated by the neutralization of dilute H2SO4 by dilute NH3. The first branch of the graph reflects the disappearance of hydrogen ions during the neutralization, but after the endpoint has been reached, the graph becomes almost horizontal since the excess aqueous ammonia is not appreciated by ions in the presence of ammonium sulfate. It is possible that you can identify the actual amount, the actual graph through or actual progress of any kind of chemical reaction with the use of conductometric titration or with the use of conductometry. Okay. Our next point is the application in weak acid versus strong base titration. How conductometry plays an important role in weak acid with strong base titration. So, in the titration of weak acid with a strong base, the shape of the curve will depend upon the concentration and the dissociation constant of the acid. Okay, generally it happens because of this only, right? We need to understand it through the curve. Thus, in the neutralization of acetic acid with sodium hydroxide, the salt, which is known as sodium acetate, which is formed during the first part of titration, tends to repress the ionization of the acetic acid still present so that its conductance decreases. Now, what will happen next? So, the rising salt concentration will however tend to produce an increase in conductance. In consequence of this opposing influences, the titration curves may have minima, the position of which will depend upon the concentration and upon the strength of the weak acid. Okay, here it plays an important role. Weak acid and strong base, both of them plays a very important role. So as the titration proceeds, somewhat indefinitely at the end point, and the graph will become linear after all the acids has been neutralized. So this is the thing that we need to understand, that how the graph will be progress, because the graph only gives us the idea, the value of the conductance throughout the graph that shows then which kind of titration is there. It shows the nature of the titration also, it shows the endpoint of the titration also, it shows the progress of the titration also. How it is possible for us that we can actually analyze it through this things, right? It is only and only possible through such kind of conductometric titration. Now, let's move on to the next one, which is potentiometric titrations. So, potentiometric titrations involves the measurement of the potential of a suitable indicator electrode with respect to the reference electrode as a function of titration volume. Generally, the potentiometric titrations provides more reliable data than data from titrations that use chemical indicators and are particularly useful with colored or turbid solutions and for detecting the presence of unsuspected species. Now, let's talk about the principle and instrumentation. A typical setup for potentiometric titrations is given in the figure that I will show you. Titration involves measuring and recording the cell potential after each addition of the titrant. Okay? The titrant is added in large increments at the outset and in smaller and smaller increments as the end point is approached. You need to understand that what we are doing here and how we are doing or how we are converting it here. Okay? So here in the image, as you can see, pH meter, or I should say that potentiometer, both of the electrodes are inserted. In both of them electrodes are used. One shows the burette. Below we have magnetic stirrer, or on magnetic stirrer we have a beaker in which our solution is there. A saturated Calomel electrode is utilized here. So what we need to do here is sufficient time must be allowed, okay, for the attainment of the equilibrium after each addition of the reagent by continuous stirring. And for this, a magnetic stirrer with stirring magnetic bar should be used. Potentiometric titrations can be classified as precipitation titrations, as complex formation titrations, as oxidation titrations, or reduction titrations. And even they can also be known as oxidation reduction titrations, right? So for all these kinds of titrations, to get the perfect results, to get better results than that of the normal titrations with the use of burette, we use here a particular method which is known as potentiometric method, right? Here you need to understand the method is known as potentiometric. Okay, the titration is known as potentiometric titration. The instrument which is used is known as potentiometer. Okay, so these are the words which are involved in this particular kind of technique. Let's talk about the applications of it here. So if we talk about it, several methods can be used to determine the endpoint of potentiometric titrations. The most straightforward one involves a direct plot of potential as a function of reagent volume. Here, endpoint detection with the potentiometric titration has been shown. In this particular image, as you can see, on left hand side we have cell potential or pH is written there. On right hand side we have volume of titrant which is present in ml. Now here if you can observe, at the starting the points are just raising, the volume of titrant as soon as it raises, the cell potential also gets raised, and at certain point a curve is being shown. After that particular curve, then you get your end point. We can take the cell potential and we can observe that this is the potential which is utilized for our end point. It becomes straight at the critical point. It becomes constant, nearly constant, not properly constant, but it becomes nearly constant at that particular time. And afterwards, it suddenly again changes. So this graph, which has been shown that from left hand side to from right hand side, shows the a particular steep release. Okay, that steep release is basically due to continuous increase in the cell potential. Although you have added certain anode, you have added certain nitrates in it, but it shows you a steep release. It doesn't give you many more changes in the graph. It doesn't give you many more changes in the cell potential, and because of it, it gives you the exact endpoint in any kind of titration. So here it is also known as potentiometric titration. I should say that it is known as determination of endpoint or determination of endpoint using any kind of potentiometric titration. Okay. Now next one is pH and its measurement. First of all, let's take a look on what is a pH. So pH can be defined as the concentrations of hydrogen ions, and indirectly hydroxide ions are given by the pH number, right? And it is defined as a negative algorithm of the hydrogen ion concentration. So the equation which can be written here is pH is equal to minus log of H plus. Concentration of H plus ions gives rise to the pH. It can range from 0 to 6.8 is generally considered as acidic pH, while 7.2 or 7.3 to 14 is considered as basic pH. In between this two, that is 6.8 to 7.2, is considered as neutral value. Right? In the different substances lies in this particular pH scale. Some of them can be acidic, some of them can be alkaline, some of them can be neutral. Generally, our water is neutral. Milk is slightly acidic. Citric acid is acidic in nature. Similarly, we have certain salt foods which are considered an alkaline in nature. So, these are the differentiations of a normal, these are the examples which can be given normally on the basis of pH scale. So, as I said it here, the pH scale measures how acidic or basic a substance is. The pH scale ranges from 0 to 14. pH 7 is considered as a neutral one. A pH less than 7 is considered as an acidic one. pH of greater than 7 is considered as a basic one. Right? Pure water is a neutral, but when chemicals are mixed with water or it is contaminated, then it is known as acidic water or basic water, or I should say alkaline water. Okay. Examples of acidic substances are vinegar and juices. When if we take an example of basic substances, then it can be milk of magnesia, ammonia, and examples of water. Okay. We can take an example of HCl in acid, H2SO4 in acid, HNO3 in acid. Okay. Similarly, we can take an example of NaOH, we can take an example CO3 and NCO3 in the basic substances, which are also known as alkaline substances. Right? This is very basic and this is very, very important for any kind of chemical analysis.